We're going to start this. Hello and welcome to SSW 311 Case Coordination and Strategies for Advocacy. For those of you out there, this is your videotape. Good luck with it. I'm going to go through the PowerPoint one for today, and I'm going to have to go to the course website to do it. And we're going to talk about case coordination, which many of you may actually have the opportunity in your placements to do case management, case coordination. We call it case coordination now because it's the more empowerment model. Traditional model we'll call it case management, so the language is different. So you may be out there in placement and you may hear things like case management. That gives you a hint that you're under a traditional model. I'm going to teach you both the traditional model that you're going to have to work under and the empowerment model, which is the new model that's coming through the grapevine, so to speak. So that's the more modern model. And that one, you're going to hear things like case coordination, collaborative worker, partnership. There are different names for it because there's no single empowerment philosophy. There are several that we'll go through. The books that you'll need are... Now I'm gone. Now I'm here. This one is Summers. This is a traditional approach. Very good. Really helpful. Something that you can use in placement. It has exercises for you. There are videos. The website is excellent. So the website also gives you a lot of practice. You can watch videos on how things are done. We'll be practicing a number of skills in class. And many of them come from this book. However, my PowerPoints will be labeled PPT1, PPT2. Those are mine. That's what you need to know for tests and quizzes and the final exam. There are Summers PowerPoints as well. Unless I indicate otherwise, the Summers PowerPoints are strictly for reference. So if you don't understand a concept or you want to learn more, you can use the Summers PowerPoints, okay, by all means. But use my PowerPoints for any quizzes, midterm tests, or final exams, okay? So that's the first one in the bookstore, available now. There's also, by the way, an online version, which is cheaper. So if you want an online version, by all means. This is a new textbook for the course. It's not new for this course, but it hasn't been used in many years. There is an older edition, but you would have to find someone. Maybe check Amazon.com, right? So maybe check online. The older edition's okay as well. This is the second edition. You can use the first edition. You'll probably find it on Amazon. So those are your options. But there's also an e-text, which is significantly less expensive. So check with the publisher. If you want, I can check and give you the link to the e-text. Just let me know if you're interested, okay? And then the second one, this is the other one. So this is the empowerment-oriented management, okay? This one is by Joanne Spindell, or Patricia Spindell and Joanne Nugent. Joanne Nugent works at Humber, and this is an advanced case management text, actually. So this is for people who have empowerment-oriented case management, a challenge to the status quo. It's in the bookstore. This one you will not find online, as you can see. But it is a professor from Humber who did it. I worked with her. I actually taught this course there. It is advanced. This is generally for people who are doing case management, who have been out in the field for 5 to 10 years, who came back and said the traditional model's not working. Please teach us something different that works. So the language in this is at a very high level. It's very sophisticated. Please read it. If there's language that and philosophies that you're not grasping, come talk to me. I will be talking about philosophies next week and breaking this down into something manageable. But I use the forms for sure that are in this course. So they're in this textbook, and those are the forms you use for the empowerment model. So they have like the connecting to community resources. We're going to be using these forms, and for your group case file, you're going to be using these forms in order as a part of your group case file. Our in-class exercises, you do these forms, and then I walk around and see how you're doing, make sure you're doing it right. For your group case file, what you did in class, you just stick into your group case file. You don't have to do it again. Yay! You only have to do it once, and you're working in groups. So it's not as onerous as it was last year where individually you had to do this huge case file. You're working in groups, you can divide and conquer the work. And what we do in in-class exercises, that's why it's so important to show up for the in-class exercises, is actually working towards just putting it into your group case file. You won't have to do it again. Okay?
Can you write down the name of the book?
It's in the outline. It's in the course outline as well. All of this is in the course outline, which I'm about to put on the PowerPoint. I'll be right back. Honestly. Which hair is out of place? All of them, Caroline. Okay. So your section DD, and everybody received the announcement? Does it come to you automatically?
Yeah.
Good. Good. So because I'm hoping that the announcements get emailed to you automatically.
Yeah, they do.
Okay, thank you. Are people just tired because I put them through 318 already, or do they know they're being taped and they're freaking out?
They're not being taped, they're...
Well, you're not actually, like, they don't see you, but they hear you. All right, under course documents, you'll find the textbook that I've posted, plus the other textbook which doesn't have a picture, and the course outline. The National Case Management Network Standards, which you will need this class and for the first quiz. Okay. You can't print this out. You can only get it online. So if you've been trying to print out the National Case Management Standards, it won't let you. In order for me to do that, we have to pay like a lot of money to join the club. So I'm allowed to post it, I'm just not allowed to print it. So you'll have to get it, read it online. Read it online, okay? So that one you'll need for lecture one, this National Case Management Standards, you'll need that for which we'll do today, and you will need it for your quiz, because that's what the quiz is going to be based on. That one and a little bit of PowerPoint one. The Community Action Cookbook you won't need till later in the course, but you will need it for exercise 4, which is your advocacy strategies. Exercise 4 for your advocacy strategies, which will go in your group case file, and you'll submit it all together. Okay, so again, you're doing it in class, and then you put it in your case file and submit it. I'm not trying to make you work harder, just smarter. There are additional recommended readings. They're not required, but they explain more about strengths model. They explain more about strengths model and the empowerment approach. Okay, so let's go to the course outline. Whoops. Okay, so what are we going to learn? So this is, again, I'm doing traditional case management, and you're going to learn empowerment management. I will identify, and in the PowerPoints it shows you when I'm talking about traditional case management and when I'm talking about an empowerment approach. And again, the reason why I want you to learn both is because I don't know where you're getting a job. And some models work under traditional, and some models work under empowerment. And I want to give you the opportunity to have both so you can work in both models and move into both models easily. When you go to placement, you may want to identify, if you're going to placement, whether you're under a traditional model or whether you're under an empowerment model. That's something you can think about this week when you go into placement next week, is what model am I working under? And we'll talk about models later in the course. So one of the other things that we're looking at is we'll investigate the many philosophies of empowerment models, because there are a number of them. You'll find them in the Nugent textbook, the yellow one. So you'll find those philosophies in the textbook, and we're going to go through each philosophy next class and talk a little bit about them and which work better, which don't, which are unformed or underdeveloped. But there's no single empowerment philosophy yet. And maybe there never will be, and maybe there doesn't need to be, right? But traditional model is fairly cut and dry. There's a singular model for it. You're going to learn a number of skills. So we're going to look at what kind of skills do you need to be a case manager. We're going to practice those skills, because some of you won't even have the opportunity to practice those skills in placement. So last year, some of you realized that you're not able to do some of the things that you would like to do. This may be the only opportunity you get to practice case management skills for social service workers. So we're going to be doing those skills in class, and you'll be working in either partners or your group of six to do that. But it gives you the opportunity at least somewhere to practice these skills. The skills such as information gathering, assessment and management. Do you take counseling? Some of you do, some of you don't. Those of you who are doing counseling will get your psychosocial history. You've all taken interviewing. I'm not going to go through that again. Summer's text has, I think, 5 chapters on interviewing and counseling skills. I'm not going through that, okay? I'm skipping all that because you've already got it. But you will need those skills from last year, and you will need to use those concepts when you do these assessments and you do information gathering. So, building a psychosocial history versus a biography. So the psychosocial history is a traditional model. Creating a biography is an empowerment model. You're going to learn how to do those. You're going to learn about what it means to be an assessment, which is traditional model, versus engagement, which is empowerment model. And the approaches are different. And this is all for information gathering and creating plans. You're going to learn how to conduct intake interviews. How many of you, show of hands, did intake interviews last year in placement? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so 4 of you did intake interviews. So a lot of you, you see, have not yet had the opportunity to conduct an intake interview. So that's something that we can do here in practice, in partners probably. We're going to look at... Let's see, where am I here? Service planning and connecting to community resources. So in both traditional and empowerment model, you're going to have a service plan. But they look different. We are going to do an empowerment model service plan, which you will find in the yellow textbook. Okay? That's the one we're going to work off of. And same with the community resources. We're going to use the one in the yellow textbook, which is the empowerment model. There are, Summers has its own model of service planning. It's there as a reference, but it's not something we're going to practice because it's easier and more concrete, and the empowerment model is a little harder to learn. But you will learn it. And what else are we doing? Oh yes, so other pieces of being a case manager, because who worked here in with or saw case managers or case coordinators working? Show of hands. Did anybody see, you might, how many people here are in community placements that are not adult day centers? Okay, you're going to see a lot of case management and case coordination. You're going to see people with lots of paperwork, looking overwhelmed and confused, and asking not to be bothered. Okay, and mostly on the phone or in meetings with their doors closed. Those are your case managers, okay? Because the paperwork is overwhelming. And so things that we're going to learn are organization skills, time management skills, which are essential to case coordination, as well as documentation skills. Everybody's going to learn how to legally document, how to keep up with your documentation, what kind of language to use when you're documenting, hard chart documenting. How many people here are in institutional settings? Who's in an institutional long-term care? So there's hard charting, and then there's computer charting now these days, which is different. So we're going to learn what kind of words and language are we using when we're doing documentation, and what do we need to know about case notes? So we're going to learn how to do that. We're going to learn about stress management skills, because case coordination is a very stressful job. If you've ever, anybody ever worked with or their family members work with the Community Care Access Center, CCAC, they have a very stressful job. Very stressful. Most people, first of all, don't like them, and it's not their fault, but they're having to pull back on a lot of funding because they're not getting the funding from LHINs, so, which is the sort of the funding over body, and so they're pulling back on funding from the community, and they're getting pushback because, of course, who wants their care being removed from them? So there's a lot of stress because there's a lot of anger towards case managers. If you work in the addictions field, case managers often get a lot of conflict because same with corrections, these individuals are mandated to see you. They don't want to see you. They don't want to be there, but they're there. So you're getting a lot of pushback from clients because they don't want to be there. Same with if you're in long-term care. They don't want to be there. They've been basically relegated to institutional living. That's not their choice. I think it's this. The high piercing sound is, So sometimes we work under stressful environments as well, where there's piercing noises or lack of air conditioning. How many of you have an office or even a desk to work at? Okay, so a little less than half the class. Can be stressful. Or you're working in an office and you're sharing it with somebody. Has anybody ever shared an office with someone?
Yeah.
If you don't get along, you have a problem. Okay, that's a stressful environment. Environments can be toxic. So an entire workplace can be toxic, and that's up at the management level, having to manage and something's going wrong on a global scale where this environment, and you can feel that. How many people have ever walked into any kind of work environment or placement that's toxic? You can feel it. You walk in, you can feel the stress in an environment. So stress management skills are going to be really important, which is your Exercise 5, your group presentation project, which we'll get to. Finally is the advocacy part. Because you're social service workers, you're agents of change. So as a case coordinator, often what you'll find is you're working on a one-to-one or family-to-one level. So the micro level, where you're working with clients one-to-one or with a family, and you're trying to create service plans, and you're trying to break down barriers, and you're trying to access resources. And you're working at that ground level. The problem is if you've been working at that ground level for several years, you start to recognize a pattern. That this isn't a one-to-one problem. This isn't just this one family. This is a community issue. And if it's a community issue, how do we solve it? So you start to identify in the community that there are problems, that there's resource allocation problems, that there's poverty where there shouldn't be, that there's issues around education, issues around addiction that shouldn't be there. There's no reason for it except the fact that the barriers that are being imposed on this community are likely macro in nature. So by macro, I mean federal, philosophical approaches, federal finances. We have an election coming up. Pay attention to where is the money going to when you vote for a particular party. And I hope you all vote for somebody. But where is the money going? Where are they telling you the money is actually going to go by the end of the day if you vote them in? Because that's the macro picture. And how is that going to translate to your ground level work on in your microcosmic world? How is this going to affect your clients? Are they going to get more resources or less? Because if there are less resources available, we have an impending public school strike right now. If there are less resources available, that makes your case managing job, your case coordinating job, harder. So as an agent of change, you may decide, you know what, there's something going on here that's bigger than just this one person, bigger than this community. I want to advocate with this community for change. So social workers and social service workers, and it's interesting. Social workers and social service workers are advocates for change. They're agents of change. We are agents of change. Yet, how many of us are in politics? Not many. Very few. So if we are agents of change, why are we not involved with the political setting? That's where change happens, right? So we're going to look at advocacy strategies in the Community Action Cookbook, which I've posted for you. It's a great way to look at escalating levels of strategies to help your client and work with your client to change the barriers, to break them down or change what needs to be changed. So that's part of case coordination, because while we're doing this case management, we're realizing I keep fixing the same problem. Different families, but same problem. There's something bigger going on. And for this particular class, most of you are in gerontology. The problems are what? What are the problems for facing seniors today?
Money.
Money. Money for what? What do they might need money for?
Downsize.
Sorry?
To downsize.
So they're going from big places to little places. Why are they downsizing? Why can't they stay in their big places? They can't keep it up. They can't make the stairs. They can't fit through the doorway with their wheelchairs. So they have to downsize to something that's wheelchair and walker accessible. That may be, a lot of you went through the retirement home course. How expensive is that? So monthly, what does it cost for someone who's in a wheelchair but can do most of the stuff on their own? They can go to lunches and activities and stuff. What does it cost for them to live in a retirement home?
On average, $5,000
a year?
A month.
How many of us make $5,000 a month in income? Okay. So money is a major issue. And there's not enough long-term care homes that are government run. What do we know about long-term care homes? How many are private and how many are government run? They're mostly private. There are two government run facilities in York Region, all of York Region. That's it. Everything else is private, so it's more expensive. So when you're looking at funding, that's a major issue for seniors in this particular class, because that's what you focus on as the GERO group. What are you going to do to change this? Why aren't we putting more care back into the home? Why aren't we getting more people to go do the shopping? Where are the resources to keep people in their homes? And why does it cost so much to transfer to long-term care? Why aren't there more government long-term care facilities? Right? And subsidized care facilities. And what's happening if you want to stay in the home? Where is the labor being shifted to? Are you getting the CCAC, PSWs, and paid companions to come in for free? Or who's doing it? Who's doing the care, the bulk of the care?
Family.
So the burden's been shifted to family because family are free. Okay? They don't cost. But they do. They actually do cost, because then they get sick and they take off their work, and so the labor costs actually, it does. We have to look at a micro and macro picture all kind of at the same time when we look at case management. So you have to look at, this is an issue, this is a private trouble, but it's a public issue. That's a feminist approach. So that's one of the empowerment approaches. So private troubles become public issues when you start to see a pattern. So we're going to learn advocacy skills. The ethical dilemmas and the crises that case coordinators are often presented with is something we're going to work through and problem solve at the end of the course. So how do we problem solve through ethical dilemmas? And I'll give you a number of cases to figure out. And then what do we do about these crises issues that come up? We've care planned for somebody, we've made this beautiful plan, and it's exploded because suddenly your client is homeless, or suddenly your client lost their job, or suddenly your client had a massive stroke. And this plan goes out the window. So how do we deal with life? And how do we solve problems ethically and safely? Okay. I've already done the overwhelming administrative heavy stuff. So that's basically a lot. There's a lot you're going to learn in case management, but you're going to get a lot of opportunity to build your skills. So the learning outcomes, you're going to learn how to conduct an accurate assessment of the client's needs and be able to identify their strengths. And next week, you're going to identify your own strengths in yourself and the barriers that you have to getting what you need. And so you're going to practice on yourself before week three, where we look at several different case clients, case studies, and try and identify their strengths and needs. Okay, which is, it sounds easier than it actually is, but that's what you're going to learn how to do by the end. And you're going to learn to look at internal barriers, things that happen within us that cause barriers, versus external barriers. So what would be an internal barrier? What is something stopping me from getting what I want if it's internal? Because students often have trouble differentiating.
What was the question, sorry?
What would stop me from something I want that's internal? So let's start with our diploma. What might be something internal that's stopping me from getting my diploma or in my way?
Self-confidence.
Self-confidence may be something that's an internal thing. What else? Is there something else that maybe might stop me internally from getting my diploma? Pardon?
Family problems.
So emotional, personal problems. Okay? So those are internal pieces. What would be an external piece that's stopping me from getting my...
Society.
But what specifically might be a barrier?
Money.
Illness.
What else? Illness, and see, that's where illness can be internal or external. So if you have a mental health issue, it is internal, but really, it's an external issue because we don't know how, we don't set up society to support that. Does that make sense? So the problem that students often come upon is they mix up internal with external. But some issues are both internal and external. If I have a visual disability, that's an internal problem, but really it's an external problem because society's not set up to accommodate me. It's not really my problem, it's society's, because this is a visual world we work in. Learning disabilities. It's an internal problem because not everybody has it, but really it's an external problem because we don't teach in a multitude of ways in order for you to access information, and we don't ask you to demonstrate your knowledge of your information in a variety of ways. We say, here's your multiple choice test, whether you like it or not. Show me what you know. Okay, or we give you a textbook to read and say, read it, whether you can or you can't. That's a macro issue. Okay, that's an external issue, not an internal issue. So some of them are gray. Some of them go from internal to external. They can be both, as long as you can understand what the external part of the issue is and what the internal part of the issue is. Then we look at comparing and contrasting the traditional and contemporary model. So you should be able to do this by the end of the course. What does an empowerment model look like versus a traditional model in Canada? Identifying organizational structures. We're going to go through and you're going to try and figure out from your placement what kind of organizational structure do I work in, and we'll learn that in class next day. Is there are different types of organizational structures, and it matters because the way you structure an organization, if it's a pyramidal structure with one power person at the top and then the power dissipates as it goes down, you're automatically in a traditional model. You can't take a pyramid and flatten it and make all people equal in that model. So already you're going, even your paperwork and your forms are going to be traditional. So the way your organization is structured dictates the policies and how you work. So it matters. And so if you don't understand why you don't like being in a certain placement or a certain work site, it may not be a personality conflict. It may not be even that you don't like your career. It may actually be that you don't like working under that structure and that model. And that if you did the same thing in a different model, you would love it. So you have to be conscious of that. Demonstrations of proficiency in case record documentation. I want you to be able to document professionally. I want you to be able to know how to keep a file, what should be in a file depending on the type of clients that you are going to be working with. So you're working with seniors. What kind of things should you see in a file, or might you see in a file? with seniors?
Cognitive abilities or disabilities.
Okay, so assessments. You're going to see assessments on abilities. What else are you going to see in a file? What if they have dementia? Or if you work in the general population, what if they're adults with developmental delays? Significant developmental delays and intellectual delays. What other things are you going to see in that file?
If they're on the watch list, like if they wander or...
But that would be on their file. It would be right on the front of their file with their picture and alert list.
Medical background.
Hmm?
Like your medical background.
Medical background. What else?
Family history.
What else?
Financial
background. Are they on ODSP? Are they on GIS? Are they on OAS? Are they, who funds them? What else? Are they on OW? All these acronyms getting thrown out at you.
Dietary
might be on there.
Religious
might be on there. Cultural might be on there, right? Power of attorney or substitute decision-making papers may be on there. If you're working with children, you must find out, and it's a divorced family or separated family, or it's a single parent family, you have to find out legally who has custody. Is it sole custody or joint custody? And we'll talk about why that matters later in the course, okay? It matters, and you have to have proof, okay? Name changes. If a legal name change has happened, you have to have proof.
How they work well with others,
yeah. Also, if they're newcomers, documentation, refugee status, permanent resident, citizenship, visa, what's their status? Do they have a SIN card? Do they have a license? Do they have a birth certificate? For eligibility purposes, you're going to need copies of all that. Has anybody ever walked into an office like that and they've been asked for their license or some kind of identification and they take it, they photocopy it, and they give it back to you? They need that for their files. It's a legal documentation. They have to have it. So do you. Okay? So do you. So we're going to learn what type of population are you working with and what kind of files do you legally, are you required to have copies of original documents, okay? Because that'll matter. Your file can be investigated and audited to see if you're doing your job properly, or if something goes wrong, they're going to review your file to see, did you screw up? If you didn't, you're fine, okay? We're going to look at developing a service plan. Identifying appropriate services, so you're going to learn what resources are out there for your client, and are they appropriate? Do they have wait lists? Are there fees? Can they get there by transit? Is it wheelchair accessible? Whatever. Is it at the right time? Do they work? And so you're sending them to a link program in the middle of the day, and they work. So resources, are they appropriate? We're going to look at, after we create this plan and we do these resources, what else might be needed in order to leverage the strength and the power, the strategies you have to make a few phone calls to make this happen? How are you going to implement this program? How are you going to monitor and follow up? How are you going to evaluate for these other resources that are available? How are you going to work in a team? Because you work with a lot of different people when you're case coordinating. And then we're going to do the stress management skills. So how do you manage your caseload? Identify ethical, legal, and risk management issues. You're going to learn about the risk tree. I've posted it, but we're going to go through it. What happens if somebody's going to harm themselves? What happens if somebody's going to harm others? What happens if it's a child at risk for neglect or abuse? And what happens if it's a senior at risk for neglect or abuse? And I know you know those are the three things that you need to do because you have relative confidentiality, and so those are when the breaches happen, right? You've been taught that. These are the three reasons why I might breach. But do you know who to call if you have to breach? No. Do you know what child abuse looks like to identify it? Probably some, but probably others you don't, okay? So you're gonna learn that next piece, which is how to identify whether harm is breachable, and who do I call? What do I do next in order to protect my client and work with them, or to protect that vulnerable adult? So you have to know what that looks like. And if you don't know what abuse looks like, child abuse, for example, How are you going to breach for it? How many people know if you throw a frame against a wall and smash it against the wall or punch a wall in front of a child, that's actually breachable? That's reportable. How many people knew that? It's not common knowledge. How many people knew if you tear a teddy bear's arms off, it's reportable? If that's the favorite teddy bear, it's reportable. But you didn't know that, okay? There are many nuances, and for seniors, if they have hemiplegia, paralysis, and you put the food on the side that they're paralyzed and leave them, that's abuse. That's reportable. So there are things that you may not know. The obvious is a physical abuse. Yeah, we know about that. And verbal abuse. Yeah, we know about that. There are other types of abuse that are reportable that you probably aren't aware of and need to start paying attention to. So does that help in terms of the risk tree? So you're going to learn a lot more about the risk tree. Finally, I'm not going to go through the core literacies and the vocational standards. You can read them on your own. There are vocational standards for SSW and there are vocational standards for SSWGs. But let's go through the outline, because I know you're all waiting with bated breath for that. Can I shrink this down a little? Is that okay with everyone? If I know how? Thank you. There we go. Is that okay?
Just like
one bigger? Okay. Is that okay? Okay, so this is the topic outline for the Wednesday, Thursday, Friday section only. The Tuesday section has their own separate outline because the dates, the holidays, the Seneca experience means that things have been adjusted for them. So you have to look at your Tuesday outline if you're a Tuesday section to see your outline. This is for Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Okay? I know, it's Wednesday too. Stop being so observant. Okay, lecture one. So this lecture, we're going to talk about this outline, the assignments, the expectations, and define. There's a PowerPoint one that I'm going to define case management and review this is done wrong. I flipped the acronyms. The National Case Management Network Standards, the NCMN standards. So you'll see CMNN and NCMN. It's NCMN. I'm just screwing up the acronym. It's my little dyslexia for you. So I will screw up the acronym. You'll see it in a variety of different places, a variety of different ways. It's NCMN. It's all the same thing. Okay, so we're going to go through the standards, which are available online, and they are not printable. So if you want to review them, bring your laptops in or do it online and read them online, but we'll go through them today, okay? And next week is a quiz on your National Case Management Network standards, okay? So for the Thursday class, you have a quiz next week. For the Tuesday class, you have it the week after because we're not there. So next week is your first quiz. Again, they're multiple choice, 20 questions. So multiple choice, 20 questions.
From PowerPoint 1
and the National Case. And PowerPoint 1 refers you to the National Case Management Standards. So you still have to use that document because the PowerPoint refers you to the NCMN standards.
And that document's on there?
Online. Yeah, it's in the document section of the website. So the NCMN standards are in the document section of the website. All my PowerPoints are in the information section, and it's PowerPoint 1 that you need. Okay, so PowerPoint 1, we'll go through it, you'll see. We'll refer you back to this document once we get to the actual lecture. So it's quiz 1 on the National Case Management Standards, and then we do relevant theories and models of case management and understanding organizational structures. So we're going to talk a lot about philosophy and theory and organizational structures because they go hand in hand. The essential, remember last year we talked about mission and vision statements, and I kept saying, what's the mission? What's the vision statement? What's the mission? Your mission and vision statements at placement and in agencies dictate their philosophy. Their philosophy dictates their organizational structure. It all goes together. It all matters. And then their organizational structure dictates how you work. Okay? And that will be if we don't get through all of PowerPoint 1, which I'm sure we will. I'm optimistic. It'll be PowerPoint 2. You can read Chapter 3 in Summers to augment the PowerPoint. And it's Chapter 2 and 3 in Spindell for the empowerment model philosophies. So you won't get the empowerment model philosophies in Summers. You'll get them in the Spindell Nugent yellow text. Okay? Does that help? Then Lecture 3. What are your roles in case coordination? What are the client roles? What does a traditional approach look like? What does the empowerment approach look like? And we're going to start off with the strengths model. And what are we going to do with the strengths model? We're going to discuss the exercises for personal self-care goals, which actually we're going to try and do today's, so that because there isn't as much today, and we're going to identify strengths and barriers of the clients. I'm going to give you the cases of five clients, and you're going to identify in your group of six. By then, you'll know what your group of six is when you sign up, and that group of six, by the way, goes through the whole semester. So you're going to identify in your group of six the strengths and the barriers of each client. Okay. In week two, you're going to identify, like I said, the strengths and barriers of yourself. So first you'll start on yourself, then you move to the clients, because it's often easier to understand a concept when we do it on ourselves. Okay. And then in we're back to week three, stress buster group one goes. So we're into stress busters. So I'll talk about what the stress buster assignment is. And it's fairly easy, it's not that hard. It's a peer evaluated project. So each group will have to make copies of the rubric, or they will have to let people know in advance that they can email me a digital version of the rubric. And the rubric is in the outline. Did everybody see that? Pretend like you read it. Yes. Yeah. It's in the, yeah. Okay, pretend you read the 22-page outline. Yeah. So it's in there. Okay, you either can make copies for the rest of the class, so 31 copies, because there's six of you in the group that don't need to evaluate. Yes, but there's a rubric, flip back one. There's the rubric. Yes, so that's the rubric. So you can make the 30 some odd copies. I will allow you to evaluate yourself as well, boost your grade up a little bit, unless you mark yourself very low, in which case you and I should talk about self-esteem. But you can evaluate yourself as well. I gather them all up, I add up all the marks, I divide it by the number of people who evaluated you, and that's your grade. And then I staple it all together and I give you your feedback. Okay? So that's how the group, and group one goes in week three. And I will tell you, the first two groups to go, I'm much easier on. I'm much harder on the later groups. Okay? So I'm much easier on the early groups, because you're the first kick at the can. Then there's quiz two in week four. Stress buster group two goes. Understanding client strengths and barriers, more of the same. We're going to talk about organizational structures, roles, and responsibilities, just connecting it back to understanding strengths and barriers. And building client assets, which is monologue four, or chapter four in Spindell and Nugent. And PowerPoint 4 is what I'm going to use, assessment versus engagement. That's the first stage of case coordination. Okay? And we're going to talk about psychosocial histories and how they're developed, although many of you who do counseling as your course, I'm just going to leave it. So I'm going to evaluate whether you have a counseling course or not. The G group doesn't, so you're going to learn quickly about psychosocial histories. Summers has a wonderful psychosocial history that you can follow. And then I'm going to talk about biographies, which nobody does. So biographies is which is the empowerment model, more of what I'm going to discuss. And then you'll do a personal strengths and barrier. We did that already. It's somewhere up there. Page 104 of the text in class group exercise on engagement assessments. That's this here, I think. It's nice that I didn't tell you what textbook, right? Mm-hmm. Task 9. I don't know. I'll have to get back to you. That might have been an older text. That may be the older text. But anyways, I'll have that for you in terms of the exercises. The exercises are already in the outline, so I'll tell you what the exercises are. They coordinate to the lectures. Okay? Then we have week 5. Another stress buster group goes. We talk about risk assessment, because when you're doing the assessment or engagement process, you have to assess for risk. That's when you assess for risk. So we're going to talk about the risk assessment decision tree process, how you assess for risk, and what decisions you make along the way based on the information you have. And we'll go through PowerPoint 5, which is case files. So we're going to do the in-class, we're going to do a decision tree on risk. And then we're going to learn about building a case file. So this class has already done the PHIPAA video, because you did it in a different course. You're not going to do it. The other class, the Tuesday class, will have a PHIPAA video on the Protection of Health and Information Act, Privacy Act. So, but we're going to do building a case file and what's in a case file. And remember, I just talked about that. There are a number of things you have to put in a case file. Or if you're reviewing a case file or you're receiving information and you're building a case file, you have to know what you're reading. You have to understand what it is you're reading and what it is you're receiving and the impact it has on your client. Okay, so we're going to talk about understanding a case file. And we're going to, from there, we do quiz 3 in lecture 6. And this is, again, a stress buster group 4 goes. Now, I don't know how many groups there are. We may be able to shift some of the stress busters if there's less group, if there are fewer groups. I've estimated 8 groups, but there may be less depending on the numbers I have in the class. So that's movable. So once I figure out how many groups there are, we can move things around in terms of the stress buster groups. Is that okay? Does that work? Okay. So that's movable. So if there's only, let's say, 5 groups or 6 groups, well, then I can push back stress group, the stress buster 1 and 2. And they can happen later in the term if you prefer. Or you can tell me what you want to do, okay? So stress buster group 4, then we go to service planning, which is phase 2, the traditional model and the empowerment model approach. I'll show you how to do both. We're going to use PowerPoint 6, planning and service delivery. There's some handouts that I'll give you in order to apply your knowledge and practice your skills in your group. And then the in-class group exercise will be case planning. When you get to that point, as part of consider this is all for your group project at the end of the term, you will have to select one of the 5 case studies that are presented to you in the prior lectures. Okay? So where you're assessing for strengths and barriers, you'll be given 5 or 6 case studies. And you will have to, as a group, decide which one you're going to focus on. And that's your client for the rest of the semester. So at this point, when you're service planning, you're going to service plan for the client you select based on the case studies you were given in the prior class. Okay? So once you're married to it, there's no divorce or separation. Okay? So your group has to be all on board. I don't want to hear from one group member, I never wanted to do this. This is a commitment. Write your vows. No divorce. Then on lecture 7, midterm exam. So you're going to have a midterm exam. It's an hour. For those of you with accommodation, I need your accommodation letters, because I need to know what quizzes and what tests you need up in the test center. If you want to write your quiz in class, please let me know, because otherwise I automatically send everything up. Once I know you have accommodations, I automatically send it up to the test center, and you may not want it up in the test center. So please let me know if you're going to write the quizzes in class. And the midterm exam for those with accommodation can go up to the test center. It's an hour in class. It may mean that you lose some pieces here. Just come back when you're done, whenever that is. This is almost a 3-hour class, so you can capture the rest of it. We're going to do PowerPoint 9, which is the stress management, plus the video, which is hyperlinked to the stress management PowerPoint. So for those of you who are writing in the test center, you can see this at home and you can go through it at home, and it's hyperlinked to the video, so you can get it at home. You're not missing too much. There is, however, an in-class exercise, so get skedaddle back as fast as you can, an in-class exercise to identify personal limits and self-care. Okay, which I think I'm handing around. So if we're able to avoid it, and this is, there's a whole piece about self-care and boundary setting that we need to do in the class. Then study week and block week, no classes. Lecture 10, phase 3, referral and monitoring. You're going to learn how to do traditional models, and you're going to learn how to do empowerment models of referral and monitoring and the language that's used. You're going to use the empowerment, in the empowerment model, the community resource template, which is found in the yellow textbook. And in class, you're going to do a group exercise on identifying resources and barriers in your group of six. More of that will be explained as it's happening. And you can read those in-class exercises, which are at the end of your outline, okay? And then Stress Buster Group 6 goes, and it's PowerPoint 7. Week 11, quiz number 4, advocacy strategies is the topic, and Stress Buster Group 7 goes as does their presentation. You can find the advocacy strategies in Spindell's Chapter 5 and 6, which are actually very good. And my PowerPoint 10, and the Community Action Cookbook, which is located on the information section. Again, as I hit these lectures, I will tell you this stuff again. This is just an overview. And we will have a video as well, which is hyperlinked to my PowerPoint. So most of the videos are already hyperlinked to my PowerPoint. You can watch them at home, okay, if you miss the class. 12, when it all goes wrong, so the ethical dilemmas and legal issues and how to solve them, that's what we're going to do in the second last class, and Stress Busters Group 8 will go if there's a Group 8. You can find the information on ethical decision making in Spindell Chapter and Nugent Chapter 5. Summers Chapter 1 and 2 talks about ethical decision making, but rely on my PowerPoints on ethical decision making and dilemma for the any kind of quizzes or tests. And the in-class exercise. So we're going to do an in-class exercise where we look at cases and we try to ethically solve them. What is the ethical issue in this case, and how do we solve it based on our code of ethics from the social service worker, the guiding licensing body, and from the UN Code of Human Rights. Everybody remember that? Way back in 147. And the Ontario Code of Human Rights, and your policies under your agency. So there's lots of overlaying layers around ethics and ethical decision making. Okay? Oopsie. Finally, we do a class review in 13. We catch up with anything we haven't caught up with in terms of content. So that's why I kind of leave it open. And we do Stress Buster Group 9, if there is one, okay? And I will hopefully grade your case files, and they will be returned to you in that class. So you'll have the bulk of your mark before you go, well, you'll have all your marks before you go into your exam. That's the hope, okay? So the case file was due the week before. Final exam week, I don't know when your final exam is going to be, but there is a final exam in this course. And you'll probably be in the gym and everywhere else. There are 12 or 13 sections of this course across 3 campuses, and you're all writing at the same time. So I don't know where they're going to put you in the schedule as a result. Okay? If you miss a quiz, again, if you're going to miss a quiz, it should be for a medical reason. You'll have to prove that. I will take that 5% and add it to the next quiz. If you miss 3 quizzes, you could fail the course because it's content that I'm assessing you on learning outcomes that won't be assessed in any other way, and it means you're incomplete, okay? Any questions about the outline? Do you want to go to the PowerPoint, or you want me to go over the exercises? Naz wants to go home. Okay, let's do the PowerPoint. Because I'm tired of talking about this. I'm boring myself.
No.
I'm boring. Believe me, I'm boring myself. Do I have a? Did they take all of the clicker things away from us? Is that what happened here? Is that power light still on?
Yeah, it's still
going. Okay. Well, I don't know where the clicker is, so I'm going to have to keep bouncing back and forth. Two classes now, I haven't been able to find my clicker. Lecture one, we did this. Assignments, we'll discuss the bulk of them next time because none of them are due yet. Classroom comport, do I need to discuss that?
What? No.
Classroom comport behavior. Really? No. Course expectations. Again, that form, fill it out. It's online. Email it back to me on what your expectations of the course are, how you learn best, what you like, what you don't like, so that I have a better idea. National case management. Yes, that's where we're starting, with the National Case Management Network standards. Let's go there. Here's our definition of case management. So case management is a collaborative, client-driven process for the provision and quality of health and support services through the effective and efficient use of resources. Case management supports the client's achievement of safe, realistic, and reasonable goals with a complex health, social, and fiscal environment. That's a big definition. Let's break it down. What does it mean? So case management is a collaborative. What does that mean, collaborative? What is collaboration? The word collaboration, what does it mean?
Working together.
So case management assumes you are going to be working with people, not on your own. And it assumes that you're working with them, not for them. And there's a difference. And we'll talk about the empowerment model and that difference. So collaboration means you're working with somebody, not for them. Client-driven process. So what do they mean?
With the client.
Yeah. But who's the driving force? Who tells you what to do? Do you tell the client what to do, or does the client tell you? Right. Here's a difference. Traditional case management really is you telling the client what to do. This is what you're going to do to make your life better and fit into society. That's how traditional case management works. And it's so much easier. I used to love traditional case management because I used to tell them what to do. And they used to do it or not. And if they didn't do it in OW, you don't get money, right? If you don't do what you're supposed to, you don't get your check, your weekly check. Or monthly, is it monthly now? Monthly. You don't get your monthly check, which is why they have bulletproof glass, right? Anybody ever seen an OW office?
It's so cold in here.
Blankets.
It's so cold.
You can get up and do, nobody will see you do jumping jacks in the back. Okay, so there are different parts of the field where you dictate to the client. But case management really is supposed to be collaborative and client-driven. The client tells you what to do, what they want done, whether you like it or not, and you may struggle with that. And those of you in Jero who saw Mr. Nobody struggled with that concept of what you wanted the client to do versus what the client wanted, because you really thought you could make their life better. They were making their life so much worse, but client-driven means hands-off. Okay, so client-driven process for the provision of quality health and supportive services. So you're providing services, basically, is what it's saying. Quality. Does it say top quality? Does it say poor quality? Just quality. I don't know what kind of quality. I have a problem with that word. It's really unclear. There's a lot of wiggle room for poor quality to be in there. So quality, health, and support services. Which health services? What do they mean by support services? I don't know. Right? through the effective and efficient use of resources. I like this word efficient. What does this mean? What is it implying?
Like